Ben 10 Alien Force for the Nintendo DS. This was my first DS game, and because of that, it kind of has a special place in my heart. I was one of those kids that only got video games for their birthday and Christmas, so this was my only DS game for a while. Obviously, I played the hell out of it, and I remember having a blast. I mean, come on, it's a video game of a cool cartoon I was obsessed with at the time. How could I not have fun with it? So, yeah, I thought this game was amazing back then. Let's see if I feel the same way about it now. What the? Oh, yeah, I'm playing this on an emulator, by the way. Don't really know how to capture gameplay on an actual DS, and if I did, I still wouldn't be able to because I don't have the actual game anymore. Yeah, it's kind of a sad story. I had to be friends with this weird kid back in elementary school. I remember him coming over to my house to play one day. He pissed me off at some point and I snapped back at him. I guess that was too much for the guy, and his feelings got hurt. So he went out to my backyard to sulk. I thought, crap, can't have this kid be mad before he leaves, because I'd probably get in trouble for hurting his feelings. So I made the stupid decision of giving him my copy of Ben 10 Alien Force. I remember giving him a whole speech about how it was my first DS game, and I think I was doing that to make it seem like it was special. I don't think he would have felt better if I seemed like I was just giving him the game to shut him up, you know? So yeah, I'm an absolute idiot for giving away the game back then. That was a major tangent. Let's get back to the actual game. The game starts off with a cutscene. Ben, Gwen, and Kevin are driving around. Kevin has a tracking system that finds alien tech, it goes off, some forever nights pass by, and they decide to investigate. The level starts, and a four-arms alien, who really let himself go, approaches Ben and tells him it's too dangerous to continue. Ben refuses, says they're on the same side, the four-arms guy leaps away, and now the game really starts. It's a standard side-scrolling beat-em-up game, but since it's Ben 10, you can turn into your favorite alien heroes. You only have five options: Humongousaur, Swampfire, Echo Echo, Goop, and Chromastone. Should have called it Ben 10 divided by 2 Alien Force, if you know what I mean. Cause 10 divided by 2 is 5. When you start the game, you can choose between Swampfire and Humongousaur. You unlock the rest as you progress through the game. One thing I want to note is, the game tells you to select aliens using the touchscreen. We're expected to touch the sides of the Omnitrix to turn the dial. If you tap the center of the Omnitrix, you turn into the alien you're currently on. Now, doing this is stupid. What they don't mention is that the shoulder buttons also do this. L rotates the Omnitrix left, R rotates it right, and pressing both at the same time transforms and reverts you. If I'm fighting a group of enemies and want to switch aliens, focusing my right hand on the stylus to use the touchscreen is going to prevent me from using the face buttons, making me vulnerable to an attack. Maybe you're a complete savage who reaches their thumb over to touch the screen, but that's still not as efficient as using the shoulder buttons. Your index fingers are free, why not use them? Anyway, we move left and right with the D-pad, jump with B, do standard attacks with Y, and special attacks with A. You don't have much when you start off. You have a two-hit jab, a special attack, a combo you can pull off by pressing Y followed by A, and that's pretty much it. You can better your moveset with upgrades, but I'll get to that later. So, what are we doing right now? Well, we're in a shipyard fighting some Forever Knights. Most of them have swords, and some have those alien guns from the first episode of the show. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't remember the Forever Knights ever having these swords in the show. I know they had the blue ones in the original, but I don't think these energy swords were ever present in Alien Force. It's not a big deal, obviously. They needed melee enemies, so they just took the energy swords from classic Ben 10 and made them orange. Nothing wrong with that. Alright, beat the first level. Now we get to see the main menu. So, these are all the levels we'll have to go through. Each row has three levels, followed by a boss stage. We also have a database section, which I'll talk about later, and the upgrades section. Each alien has six upgrades: a health boost, two attack boosts, YYY and YYA combos, and a charge for your special attack. You purchase these upgrades with P. Not too sure what that stands for. Points? I guess it's like the bags of P Link gets in Zelda 2. Anyway, points are not score. Your score increases from killing enemies, and doesn't really affect anything. Points are acquired from these yellow orbs scattered through levels. Enemies also drop these. You don't really collect many points when playing through one level, so if you want to buff up with upgrades before progressing much, you may want to replay the first couple levels a few times. I didn't do this when revisiting the game, though. I just went through each level once and upgraded whenever I had enough. I didn't get the health boost till after I finished the level before the second boss. Anyway, the upgrade you want to buy immediately is the YYY combo. The two-hit jab you start out with is puny. There's a decent amount of end lag after the second jab hit, which makes combat for the first couple levels feel a bit slow. So, yeah, the three-hit jab is a must. The next thing you want to get is the health boost, then the offense boosts if you can. The charge attack is pretty useless. Don't waste any points on that unless you've gotten the more important upgrades. The YYA combos are cool, I guess, but not vital, except for chromastones, but I'll get to that later. Anyway, let's continue playing. So, aside from collecting those point orbs, you can also find three Omnitrix emblems. A green one, which increases how much you add to your score, a blue one, which makes you invincible, and a red one, which boosts attack output. These all wear out after a few seconds, so they aren't too helpful. I was never thankful for getting these. If I ever got something like the blue emblem, I just thought, oh cool, I guess I can just run through the next couple of enemies I encounter. Anyway, you can also get health pickups, extra lives, score bonuses, as well as hidden collectibles. Each level has a plumber's badge, which looks way too similar to the green Omnitrix emblem, and a Grandpa Max hologram. Getting these unlocks stuff in the database, which, like I said earlier, I'll get to later. Aside from Forever Knights in these shipyard levels, the only other enemies we run into are these drones, which weren't in the show, by the way. They like to stay off screen, then swoop in and hit you. I found these, and the other flying enemy we'll run into later, pretty annoying. The fact that these drones are off screen to begin with is dumb, but for some reason, when you get hit, jump, then try to attack these flying enemies, your aerial attack just doesn't come out. It's super annoying because you'll jump right into the enemy thinking you're about to hit it, your attack won't come out, and you'll just get hit by the enemy again. Like, look here, I get hit, I jump up to attack. I'm pressing the attack button, but nothing comes out, so I get hit again. This only happens sometimes, so it's not that big a deal, but it's still pretty annoying. Alright, we're done with the shipyard levels. On to the boss, which is a Tekadon robot. In the show, we first encounter one of these robots in the episode, The Gauntlet. The gang beats it, Kevin keeps its severed hand in his car, Cash and JT steal it, and Cash slowly gets consumed by it, only to get it off using sheer willpower at the end of the episode. Ben says, "It's Tekadon," before we start the fight, which is pretty silly since Tekadon is more like a brand name, not the name of the robot. Anyway, the Tekadon robot has three attacks. A big laser that he likes to spam, one where he jumps and shoots a bunch of slow-moving Cherry Mike and Ikes, and one where he jumps into the background and launches some... grenades? Why would some robot of alien origin produce and shoot a man-made explosive? It doesn't even look that good. The lead artist honestly could have made a shaded ellipse with a color similar to the Tekadon, and that would have been fine. The robot also throws barrels onto the stage occasionally. They don't hurt you unless one of the Mike and Ikes hits them, in which case the barrels explode. In order to damage the Tekadon robot, you have to drain the blue health bar first, which is done by simply attacking it. Once the bar is drained, the robot's armor dissipates and reveals its inner skeleton, which you must attack to truly damage it. The skeleton is clearly robotic, but it always looked eerily human to me, just with some extra wires. I like to think this Tekadon robot is the same one Cash almost got consumed by, but we're in a timeline where it fully took over him, and he completely decomposed within the robot, leaving nothing but a skeleton that was slightly enhanced with some metal and wires. Anyway, after a few seconds, the Tekadon robot rebuilds its armor, and the blue health bar refills. If you're too close when this happens, you take damage and get flung to the other end of the stage. It's a very simple boss. It's not hard, but pretty monotonous. I barely beat it first try. Once you beat it, the forearms guy from earlier shows up. His name's Gorvin. He says he's a plumber that was sent to investigate the hybrid. They're apparently getting pretty dangerous alien tech, and Gorvin has to stop them. The gang agrees to help him retrieve these pieces of tech, but you don't actually gather any of it during gameplay. It's just implied. We're infiltrating a warehouse for the next few stages. First level is like the outside of a warehouse, second one is inside, then the third one is like the hidden alien part of the warehouse no normal humans are supposed to find. Aside from the Forever Knights and drones, we start encountering DN aliens here. The yellow ones do some close range attacks, while the purple ones huck loogies. Honestly, the DN aliens creeped me out as a kid. I think it was really just their heads. That exposed brain, that mouth that could shoot gross yellow gunk, and the piercing gaze of that single, gigantic eye. Their high-pitched shrieks in the game also made them more unsettling. They were pretty pathetic enemies in the show, though. I remember them just running away most of the time. Anyway, there are also DN aliens in suits. I'm pretty sure these are supposed to be those DN aliens from the third episode of the show. We also encounter this robot thing. Wasn't in the show, but I guess it's implied that it's something the Forever Knights got their hands on. You could also say that's the case for the drones. One thing you may have noticed is that I've been playing a Swampfire this whole time. That's because he's the best alien in the game. Objectively, there's really no reason to play as any other alien. Swampfire has decent movement speed and his attacks are pretty good. His special attack in particular is the best move in the game. It's three separate fast-moving projectiles that you can spam, and it just demolishes anything in its path. If it didn't get boring, I'd probably just spam this move the entire game. Anyway, I just said there's no reason to play as any alien except Swampfire, but that was kind of a lie. The third warehouse stage introduces metal walls that you can only get past by destroying them with Humongousaur. So yeah, you technically can't beat the game by being Swampfire only. These walls are in this one level only though. They never show up in any of the later levels, which is honestly pretty ridiculous. Why introduce a mechanic early in a game once and never use it again? That's like if you're playing a Mario game, but question mark blocks only show up in level 5 or something. I don't know. I just think there could have been more unique level design if they incorporated these walls in more levels. Actually, no. To me, these walls are kind of a nuisance. They're just in the way and have no unique qualities. Just whack them a few times with Humongousaur, then switch back to the alien you were using before. The only time I noticed a unique level design choice with the walls was near the end of this level, where there was an incline near one of these walls, allowing you to jump on top of it. Once on top, you could get a Grandpa Max hologram, which would be impossible to do if you decided to break the wall. So yeah, the metal walls are kind of stupid. But wait, this level branches off at the beginning. We have the upper path with the metal wall, and a tunnel below it. Can we take the bottom path to avoid being Humongousaur? Well, yes, but the bottom path is so narrow that the game automatically transforms you into Echo Echo when you enter. This is the only part of the game where the player is actually transformed without their input. It's another weird level design choice. So yeah, because of this one level, it's impossible to do a Swampfire only playthrough of the game. Okay, now we're at the second boss, which is Gorvin. Yeah, turns out he was just using us to get his hands on the alien tech, which he planned on selling to the hybrid. Anyway, this boss isn't very complex. He does a few melee attacks like a belly flop, stomp, punch, and a ground pound. He also has an attack where he jumps to the edges of the stage and shoots a strawberry Mike and Ike using an alien gun. It's his easiest attack to avoid and one that leaves him most vulnerable. His most annoying attack is the one where he spins around the stage. It's very hard to avoid since you can barely jump over it, and Gorvin just does it forever. It's pretty much impossible to beat Gorvin unless you block. That's right, folks, you can block in this game, by holding X. And this is the only time it's mandatory. Blocking doesn't make you invincible, though. You're still vulnerable from behind, so if you don't want to take any damage from Gorvin's spin attack, you'll want to quickly run to an edge of the stage, face Gorvin, then block. That way, he can't get behind you. So yeah, block his melee attacks, hit him whenever he's shooting lasers, and you should be good. Gorvin's definitely the easiest boss in the game, especially when you figure out you can block. If you look at the gameplay, I had pretty low health when beating Gorvin, but I'd say I wasn't just fighting him, I was fighting my patience as well. This is a very boring fight. You can really only hit Gorvin when he's shooting lasers. If you open up for an attack any other time, you're probably just going to get hit, so it's not a favorable exchange. You're really just blocking the entire time, which isn't that fun. I don't know. The other bosses in this game are just way more unique. After beating Gorvin, the gang sets out to the desert to find a DN alien hideout. There's not much to say about these levels other than we're introduced to some new enemies. We first encountered regular DN aliens in the third warehouse stage, but now we run into those pods that spawn those creepy DNA alien facehuggers from the show, Xenocytes. Another reason Swampfire is the best alien is that his special attack instantly kills these pods, though I'm sure there are other attacks that are just as effective. If you wait too long to kill these things, they spawn the Xenocytes. They have really tiny hitboxes, so it's pretty difficult to hit these things with most attacks. But remember, we're Swampfire. Just spam his special attack and it'll kill them. Null Guardians are also here, but I guess they're technically not Null Guardians because the artist just recolored them. The second they're on screen, they start charging towards you. Once they're close enough, you just get hit. They don't even have an attack animation. Just the second they're close enough, you stagger and take damage, and that's pretty annoying. After hitting you, they back off for a second to give you a chance to retaliate. Pretty crappily programmed enemies overall. We also have these, I don't know what they are. I guess they're wild mutt type enemies turned into DN aliens? There's not much to say about these guys. They're standard enemies. But I always hated them because of their mouths. Just look at their saliva strands. There's not even any dripping. It all just swings around and doesn't even fall. I always found these guys gross. Oh, there's actually one more enemy introduced in these levels, stalactites. These things are kind of annoying. They're always off-screen, so you'll never know where they are unless you've played through the level enough times to memorize their placements. They fall pretty quickly too, so you're probably going to get hit by each one unless you know it's coming, or you're lucky. Alright, done with the levels. The boss stage surprisingly doesn't start you right in front of the boss. You move forward and eventually get blocked by some tangled vines. Then some spiny vines start shooting out of the ground and you need to take them out to progress. Continue on and you'll make it to the actual boss, which is a DN alien wild vine. I found this thing pretty scary when I was younger. Not only did I find the boss's appearance creepy, but the environment as well. Unnatural plant overgrowth used to kind of creep me out as a kid. Now, before you comment something stupid, I'm not saying I'd start freaking out if I saw a tree root grow under a sidewalk. I'm saying unnatural plant overgrowth in video games and other media kind of creeped me out. They always found a way to make it unsettling. Look at the environment here. These vines are all over the place, puncturing the ground and wrapping around the pillars and walls. It's literally an infestation. If the source of these vines, you know, the alien, stayed alive, it could easily infest the entire world. At that point, the alien wouldn't be attacking us, it would just be these out-of-control vines it's producing. Kind of like that episode of Classic Ben 10 where some alien fungus was slowly spreading. The source was just chilling underground while its minions were out there terrorizing Ben, Gwen, and others. Metroid Fusion also had a creepy segment like this. The station's power goes out, and when you go to check out the core, the entire area is covered in ivy. Then you later get to an area of the station that's supposed to have plant life, and there's major overgrowth. Hell, the vines growing out of the ground are twitching and everything. It's a really creepy environment. Then there's other stuff like poison ivy from Batman and the man-eating plant from Little Shop of Horrors. Anyway, let's get back to the game. So, you can't attack the wild vine immediately. There are Xenocyte pods located at each corner of the stage. You have to destroy all of them to make the wild vine vulnerable. You have to do this quickly, or the Xenocyte pods will hatch, and you'll have to destroy them all over again. Even if you destroy three of them and one hatches, the pods reset. The two ground pods are easy enough to destroy, but then you have to jump on crumbling platforms to reach the other two. On top of that, those spiny vines from earlier jut out from the side when you reach the platforms. It's actually not as difficult to reach the two pods as I remember. The vines are pretty easy to avoid, and they don't even spawn if you land on the very edge of the crumbling platforms. If you're hit by them, though, they stagger you just enough that you fall after the platform fully crumbles. After wailing on the boss for a couple seconds, it regains consciousness, and the pods reset. If you manage to deal enough damage, the boss goes into its next phase, where it starts throwing lime grenades? Again with the weird projectiles? First the Tekadon robot, now this. Wild vines already have those black seeds on their backs. The artist could have just made this sprite black, taken off the fuse, and boom, an appropriate projectile. Anyway, this phase isn't bad. The bombs are just another hazard to trip you up when reaching the top Xenocyte pods. So, kill the pods again, hit the wild vine a bit more, and now we're in the third phase. To make reaching those top pods more challenging, the wild vine grows some vines under itself that rotate clockwise around the stage. This is honestly a pretty drastic difficulty spike. The wild vine still throws those bombs, so there's a lot trying to prevent you from reaching those top pods. I mean, look, I'm actually kind of struggling here. I ran out of time, and one of the pods hatched. With a bit of brute forcing though, finishing off this boss is more than doable. After killing it, Ben finds an entrance to the Deinalian base, which I assume is this hole right here? Gwen tells him not to go in because it may be dangerous, but they're static, so Ben doesn't understand and goes in anyway. Now, before you do anything else, go to the upgrade shop, go to Chromastone, and buy his YYA combo. It's going to be insanely useful for the next level, the dreaded elevator. In this level, we're just hit with waves of Forever Knights, drones, and Wild Mutt Deinalians. It can get pretty overwhelming pretty quickly, but that's why we got Chromastone's YYA combo. It's a giant ball of energy that completely envelops you. It fills a majority of the screen, hits multiple times, makes you invincible, and even overrides enemy blocks. It's an amazing attack. Chromastone's one of my favorite Ben 10 aliens, but aside from this really useful attack, he kind of sucks here. I mean, sure, I'm killing these enemies, but look how much I'm struggling to pull off this move. I'm losing a lot of health here. It's mainly the first hit of his jab, which has no range at all. I have to be right in front of an enemy for this to even connect. So, as you can see, I'll hit one enemy, but the rest have a chance to hit me and screw up my combo execution. I was honestly getting kind of worried I'd die here. There are no checkpoints in this level, so you have to go through all the waves again, which isn't a big deal, I'm just a little impatient. So I'd probably get a little annoyed if I died. Luckily though, that didn't happen, and I got through the level first try. I also didn't notice the Grandpa Max hologram at the top left corner of the screen, and the level just happened to end as I was about to get it. On to the next level, which is just a vertical platforming section. Not much to it. Though, I am a little confused as to why Forever Knights are here. Don't they hate aliens? Are they here to fight the Deinalians or something? Clearly not, because they're still attacking me, and not them. Ew, that's disgusting. Anyway, let's move on to the last level. I think a majority of the people who played this game will agree this is the most annoying level in the game. It just goes on forever. They introduce platforms that drop you if you're on them for too long, as well as moving platforms. The level is shaped sort of like an S, and because they have these annoying platforms, one could easily slip up and drop a level or two. It's one thing to die and redo a bit of the level from your last checkpoint, but it's another thing to make a small mistake that forces you to redo almost the entire level. I don't know, I think this was pretty bad level design. You're playing through these fairly short, mostly linear levels, and now you're suddenly thrown into this one non-linear level that's super long and has new stuff that wasn't in any of the other levels. Speaking of new stuff that's not in any of the other levels, we have two new enemies, a Forever Knight with a laser cannon and this weird pea shooter thing that shoots insanely slow projectiles. Anyway, now that we're done with this awful level, all that's left is the final boss. Before we go on though, I'm gonna go back and get any plumber's badges and Grandpa Max holograms I missed. Oh yeah, did I mention you have to use the touchscreen to navigate the level select? Yeah, you have to tap the left and right sides of Kevin's steering wheel to choose a level, which is kind of dumb. I mean, it's fine, but could you have at least allowed me to use the D-pad to navigate? Anyway, when you select a level you've already beaten, you have the option of choosing normal, hard, or hero mode. Since I really don't care, I'm just sticking with normal mode. Hard and hero mode probably just make the enemies do more damage or something. Now then, let's find the missing collectibles. You know, one thing I haven't really talked about is this game's soundtrack. It's honestly amazing. Bart Reugemann's, sorry if I butchered that last name, really outdid himself here. there are only two themes I don't really like, the desert and DN Alien base ones. They're still fitting themes nonetheless. Another thing I want to mention is how quiet the game is. There aren't many sound effects. You're mainly hearing whiffs because most of Ben's movements and attacks make these sounds. There are unique sound effects here and there, but I think the main thing this game is missing in the sound effect department is player grunts. Ben's aliens don't grunt when attacking or getting hit. I think adding those grunts would make the game a little more immersive. I mean, imagine playing something like Super Mario 64 and not hearing Mario's iconic... They did add grunts to one character though, and that's Ben himself. You know, the one entity you're discouraged from playing as because the whole point of Ben 10 is transforming into cool aliens? Those are definitely not the right grunts, though. That sounds like 10-year-old Ben. I thought they just got those grunts from the console version of Protector of Earth, but I guess not since Ben's grunts are different there. They did get the Echo Echo sound effect from this game, however. Okay, I got all the collectibles, except one. I'm pretty sure it doesn't even exist, though. It's a Grandpa Max hologram that's apparently in the first level. I searched the entire level and could not find it. But, like I said, I don't think it exists. Wanna know why I think this? Well, aside from it just not being anywhere in the first level displays tutorial prompts. You know, these messages. When you collect the plumber's badge in level 1, it tells you what it does. When you collect the Grandpa Max hologram in level 2, it tells you what it does. If there was a Grandpa Max hologram in level 1, why would the one in level 2 give me the prompt? So yeah, there is no Grandpa Max hologram in the first level. It is a little annoying that it says I'm missing it in the level select though. They really should have omitted that for the first level. But anyway, I think it's time to face the final boss, which is a hybrid commander. It's an auto-scrolling stage where the boss is always behind you. You can't actually attack him directly. Get close to him, he whacks you. What you have to do is hit these little satellites. Wait till they're at the proper angle, hit them, and they'll shoot a laser directly into the boss. If you miss a satellite, or hit one when it's at a bad angle, don't worry, because the level infinitely loops until the boss is dead. This guy's walk cycle is so silly. How can you take someone who walks that way seriously? After hitting him twice, he flies to the top of the screen, shoots his nails at you, and summons some DN aliens to keep you busy. After that, the auto-scrolling gets a little faster, and the hybrid commander starts running like he ate Taco Bell and is in desperate need of a restroom. Obviously, since the scrolling is faster, it's harder to land a hit with the lasers. Hit him again, he'll do the flying thing again, and the scrolling will get faster, but he'll start hovering instead of running. Hit him twice more, take out his henchmen again, and now you're left wondering, why isn't he dead? He has no health left. Well, we have to hit him one more time, but not with these satellites. After some scrolling, you'll encounter a giant satellite that wasn't originally in the stage. It'll blast the hybrid commander with the massive laser. As you can see, I jumped up and did an aerial attack. I was never sure if this thing was scripted to shoot automatically, or you had to jump up and hit it like the regular satellites. I remember always hitting it when I was a kid, so I didn't want to take the chance and did it here. There you go, guys, we beat the game. The weather tower is destroyed, but their main computer is still somewhat functioning. Ben attempts to shut it down, but triggers a self-destruct sequence instead. Ben, Gwen, and Kevin epically escape the explosion, ponder if their fight with the hybrid is truly over, and savor their victory. Before the computer explodes, something flashes on its screen. It's a ring, but I have no idea what it means. I guess it's some secret weapon of the hybrid, but this was never in the show. I think this was supposed to be the arc the hybrid used to transport their fleet to Earth in the last episodes of Season 2. So yeah, we're done with the game. There are only two more things to go over though, those being the gallery and this button here. As you play through the game and get the collectibles within the levels, you'll get messages like new image unlocked or new character bio unlocked, and that stuff's in the gallery. There's not much to it, just a picture and a respective description. I kind of feel bad for the sucker who had to write these character bios. There's no monkeying around with this guy. Ugh, that hurt to read, and I'm sure that hurt to write as well. The new images you unlock are just concept art. No descriptions for them, just concept art 1, 2, 3, and so on. As you can see, I am missing a few gallery entries. It says, use Ben and his alien forms to unlock these images, but I'm honestly not up for doing this. I think it's too vague of an instruction. It doesn't specify how much I have to use Ben and the other aliens, and I don't really care to find out. I'm sure I unlocked everything in the gallery when I was younger though, considering this was my only DS game for a while. Anyway, on to this button thing. It's actually a mini-game, DN Alien Invaders. On the top screen, we have those recolored Null Guardians moving in a downward, sinusoidal path. Occasionally, those Forever Night drones will show up, but move straight down. On the bottom screen, we have Gwen and Kevin, who have colored hexagons numbered with dots next to them. To kill the enemies on the top screen, you must punch in the hexagons corresponding to the ones attached to them. When you kill an enemy, time is added to the countdown displayed on the top screen. When that timer goes out, the game is over. When you tap a hexagon, Gwen or Kevin will grunt and play a quick little animation. It can get kind of awkward, especially if you spam it. It's a nice little addition to the game, but I remember barely playing it when I was younger. The number above the flashing button indicates how many times you can play the minigame. Play it once, the number decrements. If you want to earn more attempts, you just have to play through some levels. I vividly remember having over 1,000 attempts, so that shows you how much I cared for this minigame back then. Alright, now we're done. So, was this game as good as I remembered? Unfortunately, no. There was fairly poor level design here and there, some enemy behavior was kind of crappy, the combat is very repetitive and monotonous, and there wasn't much reason to play as other aliens. Although it has its problems, I still love this game. It was my first DS game, and I love Ben 10. There's just way too much nostalgia here to hate it. This wasn't some port of a superior console version, it was its own game. I commend the developers for working on such a small project that probably didn't get as much recognition as the console version. All in all, I love this game. If I had to rate it, I'd give it a 7 out of 10.